Can you believe this?
No.
On the air, Sully, little Tommy, Rusty Nailz, and on stage right there is Nathan East, the most recorded bass player in the history of music. Noah East, his son. James East, three Grammys, four Tonys, and a restraining order. Trace Hodges.
So cool.
Let's just let him play.
Yes.
Can you name the bands he's played with?
Yes.
He's with Eric Clapton now, isn't he?
Yes.
This is when he played with Al Jarreau.
We don't even have to talk this show, do we?
You ever see a band with two basses and no guitar?
No.
How great is that?
Yeah, I'm available if they need it.
Apple doesn't fall far from the tree, man. That's Noah East on the Hammond B3.
Tickling the ivory.
I'll say. James East, Trace Hodgins. Can you believe that?
No, I can't. Sully.
Hey, guys. How are you? Good to see you, man.
Hey, Sully.
Look at this.
Welcome back home.
Thank you, right?
America's finest city. Good to be back.
You grew up here.
Yeah, absolutely.
Born and raised here.
Come on. Born in Philadelphia and then raised here.
Like, what time? How old were you?
I think four.
What high school did you go
born
to?
Born and raised here.
We'll see Crawford High School.
Crawford.
Crawford.
Were you the same year as Stephen Bishop?
Yeah, I think he might have been, about the same.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I have so many questions for you.
Well, one of the icons of music, of course, Nathan East, and James East, his brother.
Yeah.
Trace Hodgins. These two guys, I'm just so proud of you guys, just because you don't need to be in my band anymore. I would just join these guys and run away. And then Noah, of course. Noah is Nathan's son. Man, I watch you on Instagram. I watch you on all forms of social media, and you are amazing.
Yeah.
All right. My
this
first
is as close
question.
As we'll ever get to him.
That's my
first
boy.
Question. First question. All right, Nathan, you grew up in San Diego, the heart of San Diego, Crawford High School.
Crawford.
You're playing with Eric Clapton. You're playing with Phil Collins. You're playing with everyone.
Michael Jackson. Yeah.
Was there?
Phil Collins.
When was
Stevie
the time?
Stevie Wonder.
When was the time, as you were growing up in the 60s and 70s, when did you realize, hey, I got this?
Yeah.
This is, I'm really good.
Well, you know, when I was 14, I picked up the bass, and the first bass line I played was the top of the stack.
Sure.
James Brown, you know, and,
yes.
and it's like, all of a sudden, it's like you have this power in hand. And but Christ the King Church, right in Southeast San Diego, is where my brothers and I used to play. So that was where I picked up the first bass. It was on the altar there, and I just said, hey, whose is this? Nobody knew, and I picked it up, and that was it.
Did you go with bass because it was two strings less than a regular guitar? Because I'm thinking that's, you know, 30% less learning, right?
I've added two strings.
But he's got two strings.
So I know, what's that?
I was at City College, San Diego City College, in the early 80s, and I used to play jazz records on the radio. And we used to back sell the records and look at the back of the album. Nathan East, Peter Sprague, all those guys, you were on every single album we played. Like, every single album.
That was by design, by the way.
Yeah, but I mean,
but
you were playing traditional jazz, and then all of a sudden something happened, and then you're on a thing called MTV jamming with all the huge icons. How did that step happen?
Well, you know, while I was playing five nights a week at the Hilton Cargo Bar right here in the Mission Bay. I would play there by night. I'd drive up to L.A. after the gig, sleep in front of the studio, and then I'd record all day with Barry White.
Wow.
So that's how I was kind of like had one foot in San Diego, and then I was, you know, meeting all the guys, recording up there, and then finally it was like, okay, I better move.
Yeah.
But shout out to UC San Diego, my alma mater, which is where I met Noah's mom, my wife, Dr. Anita, and so, I mean, this place, you know, my DNA is here.
Yeah, I have to ask, who was the first group you recorded with where you saw your name on the back of a record?
That would have been actually Bruce Cameron, local, and we did an album called With All My Love. I had written the title song, and I think that was the first record that I played on, that I saw my name on, joined ASCAP off of that record.
Wow.
You ever make it to a homegrown album?
Exactly.
A KGB homegrown.
Yeah.
But then we're, you know, with Peter Sprague and then a group called Manzanita that we had. Mm-hmm. We made an album there, and it's funny because Barry White, as soon as I got the record home, I cracked it open, looked at the back, and he doesn't put the musicians' names on the record.
Oh, man.
And his reason is he didn't want anybody to steal his sound, you know, but I was so proud to be able to look up there and stuff. Yeah.
So how does it work? Because you're so well accomplished as a musician, and you're known as the best bass player in the history of music.
Wait, should I pay you now? Or?
Yeah. But my question is, when someone like, you know, Al Jarreau, Phil Collins, Eric Clapton, when they say, hey, let's get Nathan East, is there a jam session and then they say it? Okay, you're in the band. Like, do you try out or do they just say, no,
you
Nathan's
know,
in?
The first, the call I got for Al Jarreau, which was early 80s, he was in the band, his bass player got sick, and they called me, and they literally, it was back when, you know, the only way they get a song to you, they sent me the tape of the last show via FedEx. I listened to it on the plane on the way to Milwaukee, and that was my first, that was my rehearsal on the plane.
Wow. Wait.
First
and
gig was
and so wait,
by fire.
So you get off the plane, you go on stage, and you're jamming, no rehearsal.
No rehearsal, just
a
sound check, basically.
Yeah, right.
And so then I had listened to the tape that they just sent me, and then... But then I was such a big fan that I kind of knew the songs anyways.
When the MTV videos with you and Eric came out, the unplugged versions of After Midnight and, Layla, Tears in Heaven, did that kind of even skyrocket more because people saw you?
You know, that was a good, that record I think sold 30 million records, you know, Oof. Something crazy, which nowadays I don't think would ever happen again. But it was the first, one of the first real unplugs that, you know, that kind of got on everybody's radar. Mm-hmm. And of course, songs like Tears in Heaven, you know, was like, you know, the world recognized that song, you know. And so, yeah, that was a big one.
Well, and you were also part of, if I'm not mistaken, were you part of the We Are the World?
I was actually, Marcel played on We Are the
Your
World.
Your brother Marcel.
Yeah, my brother Marcel East. And I actually wasn't a part of We
really?
Are the World. But I.
Slacker.
Exactly. Worked with Quincy after that, though, yeah.
The what's interesting is that the people that you played with, Eric Clapton, Michael Jackson, Joe Satriani, Peter Gabriel, George Harrison, Ringo Starr, it kind of spans the whole, I mean, there isn't one slot here that you guys fit into. Does it matter to you? Because I know we get to introduce this young man to your right there, because you guys are playing a whole different vibe there. How do you kind of, do you have to put a different hat each time, or do you have to get psyched up for it? How do you do it?
You know, back in the day on the radio, you'd hear Earth, Wind & Fire, then you'd hear Jimi Hendrix,
yeah, right.
Miles Davis. There was no like,
right.
It wasn't like R&B station and a rocket. So it was like you heard everything. So that's what we listened to, you know. So I was listening to Chicago and
yeah.
Blood, Sweat & Tears, Earth, Wind & Fire, you know, and then yeah. all the Motown stuff.
Next you know, you're
Beatles.
Playing with them.
Yeah, exactly. You know,
this young man here is Noah East. He's your son. How much gratitude do you have that you're sitting on stage next to your son? How fun is that?
Makes me know that the piano lessons paid off.
There's a lot.
That's got to be the best. Yeah.
No, it's the best feeling ever. I mean, and he's become. I mean, he has perfect pitch. When we used to, when I was little, I'd say, okay, play the note Daddy played, and I'd play the note. You know. Then he played again.
Yeah. That helps.
Wow. Hey, Russ, tell us, what's perfect pitch?
That helps. Perfect pitch is like a strike right down the middle, you know, not above the knees. Not. But let's stick to music, Bob. I don't want to win a baseball now. The thing is that you two, when you're jamming together, father and son, you bond on that level. But musically, that's got to be heaven.
It's heaven. And plus, we have, he said, if you get me one gift for the rest of my life, that's all you have to get me is a Hammond organ. So we got him one a few months back, and we can't get him off the thing. 4 a.m, we're in there in the living room playing the thing.
That's a classic sound.
It came from a church, and so it has blessed our living room.
Blessed us too, yeah.
I was with a bass player the other day at KUSI. His name's Bobby Watson.
Hey, Bobby, yeah.
And I asked him, I said, hey, who do you look up to? Who do you listen to? And he said, Nathan East.
Oh, no, because I copied all of his licks from Rufus, you know.
Yeah. So. And then, but who did you grow up idolizing? Like, James Jamerson? Or?
James Jamerson, you know, Paul McCartney, Verdine White, Earth, Wind & Fire, you know. The reason I got a white bass is Verdine had a white bass, you know. So,
but can you dance like him on stage?
I can't quite. You know, I was trying to dance like we did a tour with Toto and Earth, Wind & Fire, and I was trying to do my Verdine White. He was in the front row, so I was doing my Verdine White impersonation, and I tore my Achilles on stage on the tune. So like I'm doing this, Brendan, all of a sudden I was like, oh, something bad has happened.
Yeah, like pickleball.
But I kept going, yeah, exactly.
So
no, he's the man.
Yeah. You were on stage once. I saw some video of it. You got Eric Clapton with you and a guitarist named B.B. King. Now,
heard of him.
When you're on stage, do you ever just say, you know, what
you think they're going to find out it's me?
What the heck is going on? I mean.
Every time. Every time. Single time.
That's yeah. right.
No, I mean, we did George Harrison's last tour, and Eric, you know, he was nervous about going, you know, touring. So Eric said, use my band. They're all, you know, will come. They're all warmed up, ready to get. So we rehearsed. We went to the Japan, and there was a picture, the poster. And I don't know how this happened, but George Harrison was there, Clapton was there, and I was in the middle. It was, it was my bad, you know. And I'm still thinking, it's a pinch me moment.
Noah, is that a pinch me moment for you too? Look to your left and see your dad up there playing.
Oh, most definitely. Because I mean, some of these people are my heroes, people I'm listening to, and then I'm looking. Hey, no, I'm going on the road with who? And I'm like, what? You going on the road with him? So
yeah.
No, it's definitely as surreal as it is for you know you guys and. It's just a blessing to be around it, you know, since being a little kid.
James, James is our bass player. James East is Nathan's brother and Noah's. So what was he like when he was a kid? Were you the mouthy one or was he the mouthy one? Because I know one of you was.
Who's the older brother?
But Nathan's older, yes.
Yeah. James is 30.
Wow, again.
I'm just
James is my little big brother.
Yeah. But yeah, we had a lot of fun, and it's been an honor to go on tour and play in Nathan's band when we've been doing a bunch of trips to Asia.
Yeah, what's interesting, so I don't know if you noticed this, we were talking about this while they were playing in the opening. There is no guitar on stage.
No.
And it's you don't miss it.
But the thing I mentioned about four-string bass is what you usually think of it, but you've got, like, I think 18 strings on that one you're playing. What?
It's a sitar.
There's a lower key and a higher key?
It's a bass guitar.
Yeah. It's
the four in the middle are the regular bass strings, but then I have lower and higher range.
Oh, yeah.
And we won't have him play the low note because it'll crack your television screens.
That's the Barry White part of it.
Will you guys throw something else out there for us?
Yeah.
Come on.
Another tune?
Come on.
Do it.
Okay. Let's go on.
Oh, well, we had a request, but we're going to play anyway.
What's it? Yeah.
Shut up and go home.
Hey, buddy.
Well, since we've been talking about Eric Clapton, let's do a Clapton song. We made this record a few years ago.
But his son, Noah, reminds me of Steve Winwood.
Mm-hmm. Stevie Winwood?
Yes.
From the Spencer Davis group.
Yeah.
And also Steve Winwood on his own.
Traffic, yeah.
Right?
The Hammond B3.
Okay, so listen, we got something for you.
What?
Before we get started with more music and talking with everyone on stage, let's do a thing called a mystery guest. And Nathan, this mystery guest is actually for you.
It's just for you.
So you're going to guess the mystery guest by answering yes or no questions. Yes or no questions. We're going to bring up the mystery guest, just the audio only. He's on via Zoom.
All right. Mystery guest, are you there?
Yes, I am.
This mystery guest is disguising his voice.
Their voice.
And so ask a yes
or
no question.
What do you mean I'm not disguising? I always speak like this.
Yeah. The helium talking today.
Are you a man or a woman?
Yes.
So, yes, he's a man.
Yes. Okay.
Second question, Nathan.
Young or old? Oh, yes or no question.
Yeah. Well, kind of old now. I guess I'm kind of old, yes.
Have you ever jammed with Nathan East?
Oh, many times. Many, many times.
Oh.
And
what do you think?
Wait a second.
He's also seen me in my underpants.
Wow. That's good to know.
You wouldn't happen to be from Brighton, would you?
Oh, come on. That was
too easy. It is the founder of the Average White Band, one of the original Heartbreakers from Tom Petty and Heartbreaker, Steve Ferroni.
Hey!
Ferroni!
It's my friend Aaron Gordon back there. He can't keep his nose out of my... Get out!
It's my mate, Steve. How are you?
I've known him longer than I've known you, Nathan, this guy, that guy there.
Really? Wow.
How you doing?
Wow, amazing. You got me on that one. How are you?
Hey, then. I'm doing very well. I was asked to pop in and annoy you like you popped in and annoyed me.
So you've been cool. Doing that for many, many years,
Steve.
But I'm gonna get to see you this weekend. I'm
gonna see you Sunday. Yeah, absolutely. I can't wait.
That's fantastic.
And, guys, Steve and I have been around the world.
Yeah, who have you guys played with together? You guys have recorded together a million times, right?
George Benson and Eric and
Ray Charles, and we did like
Ray Charles. We did like. A lot of stuff.
Everybody. Yeah. Shaka Khan.
We tortured many people.
Uh-huh. Wow. Steve's the drummer on I Feel For You for Shaka.
Oh, yeah. Is that right?
Yeah.
Steve, you were one of the original members, or if I'm not mistaken, you were with Average White Band for many, many years. Talk about that a little bit.
Yeah. Well, I was average. Everybody else was white.
Hey. Where's that rim shot when we need it? Hi-oh. AWB. That's cool.
Yeah. We made a lot of good records here, but you know, I've been very fortunate to have, I would say, three major acts in my life that I performed with. One was Average White Band, the other one was Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers.
Oh,
yeah. Been for 25 years.
How did that call come? How did that Heartbreaker call?
Oh, no, I haven't finished.
Come on,
shut
I want to hear about it.
Shut up.
Wait, I got to get the third one.
And the other one that I thought, it's like these bands is that every time I walked out on the stage, I thought I was playing with the best band in the world. And the other one was definitely Eric Clapton's band.
Oh, okay.
All that time was spent with Nathan. He's a wonderful bass player. And a wonderful human being, a wonderful person. I think that's more important even than his bass playing. Mm-hmm. Nathan, you've always been very close to my heart, you and your family. And it's always been a pleasure and honor knowing you. It's great to see you on here today.
Steve is family.
Being featured today with your stuff. And Noah, I got to say, Noah, you're just killing that Hammond organ. I never heard you play a Hammond organ before. I heard you play piano before, but the Hammond organ. That might be your thing.
Yeah, but
yes, it is.
I'm just grinding every day, man. Ever since you got it, I can't get out of it.
Yeah, I got to play a little bit with Booker T. I got to record with him a year or so ago, and boy, that was a thrill. You know, I love playing with it. I came over with an organ player, with Brian Orgo. It was the first time I came to the United States.
Boy.
So I'm kind of an organ and guitar expert.
Okay.
He knows how to play drums as well.
Many drummers already.
All right, so how did you get the call to do Tom Petty? How did you get the call to do Eric Clapton? How do all those things come about?
I have no idea.
Yeah.
I have no idea. I mean, I guess they hear you play and your name comes up, and then somebody picks up the phone and says, you know, come show up, you know. And I guess that's kind of what I do.
You're literally every time you play, you're literally auditioning.
Yeah,
you know.
Right.
Yeah. Even at the gig that you already have.
Remember that, young musicians. Yeah.
I tell you what was funny was that actually, you know, in the case of Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, you know, they were auditioning drummers, but they didn't call me to go for an audition. I got hired.
Oh.
So I was hired to come out for a week and play. And it was a top secret.
Wow.
They said, oh, they couldn't even tell me who it was that I was coming out to play with.
Of course.
And I arrived at the studio and it was Tom Petty Kenny Arnoff's drum kit was going out as my drum kit was going in.
Whoa.
And I still didn't think too much about that because sometimes you get called. I mean, it's happened with Nathan as well. He goes and plays on a record and you play on two or three tracks and then somebody else plays on another track. And so that's not unusual. I just don't even know.
You just have that attitude, like, it's all right if you love me. It's all right if you don't.
That's funny.
Listen, all I can say is that you're the first person that I've seen that I can actually honestly say is not better looking than Tom Petty.
There you go.
This is so cool.
Rusty Nailz, eh? Thank you.
I'll take it.
Steve Ferroni. Thanks for dropping by. Can't wait for you to come down to the studio and hang out with us personally. All right, bud?
No, I think I just spoke to Marcel this morning. I think we're going to be doing something in a couple of weeks.
I heard something about that. I'm not sure, potentially. Yeah. I had the opportunity to play with him on Kaboo with James and Steve. I might as well have walked off stage and started.
Yeah, I've got to say something about James. James,
uh-oh.
Get a grip.
I'm trying.
I have more questions. Let's take a break.
One last thing about Steve.
Yeah.
Talk about his humanity. When James and my dad, you know, in his last 4 days on the planet, I was on tour with Eric Clapton. Steve jumped on the plane with me and went to my house, shaved my father, took care of him, and I couldn't stop him from doing it either. You know? So that's what kind of
he's a good man.
That's what kind of family
we
Steve.
I cooked some spaghetti for him too. I gave him some good spaghetti.
Exactly.
That's awesome. I'm so emotional. I might just break down.
Steve, thanks. We can't wait to hear you. You guys,
I love you.
Will you guys Steve. Play us Happy out Sunday. One more time, man? Steve Ferroni, can you believe that?
The best musicians in the world are right here.
Yeah. It's the music show.
Yeah.
And two of the worst.
Dang, okay.
Yeah. There's some classic AWB. The music show continues on the air.
Kind of like a reunion with me and you, Nathan.
Yeah.
You know why?
Unbelievable.
So it was about 20 years ago, I went to see you with Phil Collins at Irvine Meadows.
Right.
And I walked by, I was wearing jeans and a t-shirt. I went, Nathan! Remember that?
I remember that. Yeah.
But that leads up to my next question. You've played in every great venue. When you play at a venue, you know, like, you know, the sports arena that you probably grew up in.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Do you trip out? Like, is there a favorite venue, like the Forum or?
I think the Loft 100 Studios thing. I'll just answer that Forum. I'll just answer it for him.
Right there.
Right?
Yeah, right
We're
here.
Right here.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know what I mean? You played everywhere. You ever play Hyde Park?
Yeah, played Hyde Park a couple years ago. Royal Albert Hall in London is amazing.
Wow.
How many holes does it take to fill?
I tell you.
Hey, ho.
I want to ask you, first of all, you're in college still, right?
Still in college,
and
yeah.
You're what, 30, 40 years old, I think? how old are you?
20 going on 30. Yeah, now I'm 20 years old.
Imagine 20 years old having 20. That kind of talent. Unbelievable.
I
can't. So tell me about growing up with Ringo Starr at the kitchen table. Eric Clapton is texting, you know, your dad in the middle of the night. What is that like? Is it oh, by the way at this point?
I think at this point, yeah, because, I mean, I've been being around these people my whole life, but still, these people are my heroes, you know. These people are my playlist, you know. My friends are playing these people, and it's just amazing, you know what I'm saying? He's on the phone. Hey, who you calling? I was Eric on the phone, so it's just like...
Eric!
It's kind of surreal, but at the same time, you know, this is like family, and it's just a blessing to be around it.
You realize that Russ is trying to figure out a way to steal your phone right now. So I would put it in your right pocket.
Look over there.
This is the funniest one is Stevie Wonder FaceTimes.
That's the funniest one ever.
He literally does.
He FaceTimes. Yeah. I hate when that happens. When he FaceTimes me, it's...
Yeah, yeah.
Does he really?
He does.
Jeez.
Noah, when you think about as a kid, because we all started playing instruments as kids, and I hated my parents who made me go play guitar.
Oh, yeah.
like everyone, and it seems like punishment. Going forward here, do you see yourself in straight music? I know you're going to school for business up at Berkeley. What are you thinking? You thinking of merging the two together? Or?
Yeah, so, I mean, I don't want to get rid of music, whatever happens. I just want to be as broad as possible, be as knowledgeable as possible, and, you know, having the opportunity to get a college education, I couldn't pass that up, especially at, you know, UC Berkeley. So I'm really going to see what my options are, and I just really want to be as skilled and as knowledgeable as possible. So whatever, you know, takes me down that road, I'll go down that road. But music will definitely never leave my side.
I love that.
No matter what.
I would avoid any construction projects because he's sometimes, I don't know if you've noticed this, but bad things can happen in construction.
Nate, so you mentioned George Harrison, you've mentioned Ringo. What's it like? What's it like, you know, meeting them and then jamming with them? I mean...
It's kind of like meeting you, Tommy, because you're in the Mass Radio National Hall of Fame.
But wait a minute.
Come on.
It's kind of surprising you haven't brought that out yet.
Come on.
I really want to know because I've never met a Beatle. You've been on stage with them.
Yeah.
How is that feeling? Because,
well, the first time I got a call from Ringo, I thought it was Greg actually doing his Ringo because he does a good impersonation. But these guys are just like they're right. The sweetest guys ever and. And they, you know, after all these years, it's just like they're buds, you know.
And after that initial, wow, and then, okay, we're going to talk music now.
Well, and Ringo said the greatest thing. He says, I have two favorite bass players. You're the other one.
Of course.
And Paul McCartney, obviously, you know, great bass player, but he actually was. He actually is a really good bass player.
He's very influential.
It's this way, by the way.
Yeah, he's the other one.
Right.
Yeah.
And then James Jamerson, I watched a documentary on Motown, and they were talking about, you know, Marvin Gaye's What's Going On. Mm-hmm. And they say there's an infamous story that he was so drunk while in that session that he actually played laying down
on the
stage. You hear that story?
Wow. Yeah.
And he is laying down. How does someone have that much talent where they can do that? Because What's Going On, Mercy, 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 you know, that's... The
laying down.
Well, he's literally in another world. I mean, he's like he's the number one favorite bass player. You know, like every poll you see, it's James Jamerson is number one. And he once I got called to replace him on a record, and they called and said, "Oh, we want you to." And I said, "Nope, he's the only guy in the world I will not replace."
Can I? Let's talk about the fans because obviously, when you're up on stage. And you're in front of, what's the biggest crowd? 100,000 people, 50,000 people?
250,000 is the biggest one.
Where was that?
That was Rock in Rio in Brazil.
Woo-hoo.
It was Nebworth 90, and it was Live Aid in Philly.
Do you ever get nervous? I mean, people ask me all the time. I never ever get nervous. I remember one time, the first time we stepped in front of like 10,000 people, I actually got nervous. Do you ever like these days going, there's a bunch of people out there? Or is it this point?
You're I get more nervous playing in front of 25 people.
No kidding.
Well, I'm glad we could help you out today because you were shaking up there for a while. I was worried.
I was nervous to come here today.
I've seen you up close at a small venue. It was at San Diego City College. You were like with a trio. You were playing that stand-up bass. I think Peter Sprague on guitar.
Right.
And you were just amazing there playing traditional jazz.
Absolutely. No, that was, well, we used to play at the Crossroads, 4th and Market's not there
anymore. Oh, yeah.
But that was like a legendary hangout. A lot of guys came through there.
And being on so many records, do you ever drive in your car and
hear a song. Okay, I'm on that one. The next song comes up. Yep, yeah. I'm on that
one. Is that like a road game? No. It's like you guys are driving down the road trip.
What happens
is
he doesn't tell me anything. So I'll be like, you playing on this? He'll be like, yeah. I'm like, you not telling me? Like, he just gets tired of telling me. I don't know.
Hey, when we come back, I want you to lay down and play the stand-up bass. I don't know why. I just got this vision.
But we do want to introduce you to someone. We want to bring someone up next. And you're going to love it. He has a great story to tell just as well.
More on the air coming up.
More music. More of us.
Music show. It's like music royalty.
Well, the best musicians in the entire world are right here.
Yeah, I'll tell you.
Easy. Are.
You that aren't.
Coming up next break, Lauren Finney even has an announcement about music coming
up. I love
up.
Lauren.
So she'll be on via Zoom, but I will tell you right now, one of my favorite people in the whole world, and I will tell you because I've been as a kid, when you read the inside sleeve of a record, I was one of those guys that knew Leland Sklar, Russ Kunkel, Rosemary Butler.
Wow.
And this guy named Lester Abrams right here. Lester Abrams is in studio.
What?
Dude.
Boom.
B.B. King, Stevie Wonder, Peebo Bryce, and the Doobie Brothers. And he wrote Minute by Minute. He wrote it.
Dude.
Nate, do you see? This is like, right? Right?
You know, as I was driving in today and looking at the rundown and seeing, hey, they're going to play, Nathan's going to play Minute by Minute, I pick up the phone and I call Lester. And I say, Lester, come on down to Carlsbad.
Yeah.
And you did.
It's pretty scary, I'll tell you that.
And you will be playing it today on our show.
Do you live in San Diego?
I do.
No kidding.
We're in La Vista.
So my question is, when you were in the music biz, you're still in the music biz, I know you play out, but I mean, when you were Grammy nominated back then, when you were playing with these guys, did you live up in Hollywood, in L.A. in that time?
I did. I lived smack in the middle of Hollywood.
Did you really?
Just right between Sunset and Hollywood Boulevard on Bronson Way.
No kidding.
So it's the mid to late 70s. You're in a band called Kraken with Brian Ray, who plays with Paul McCartney.
Yeah, yeah.
And all of a sudden, years later, then all of a sudden you're with Michael McDonald jamming. And you guys, how did that, tell me about that day when you guys figured out Minute by Minute.
As best as I can remember.
Right.
yeah, because they were playing rock and roll in the 70s.
We were hanging out because this band, Kraken, was like the favorite band of all these great bands that were being, that were selling bazillions of records.
Right.
Peter Bonetta, Brian Ray, these guys were tremendous players. So I had an opportunity to write, and so I would just write these songs, and they'd take the song and go, and the song would go, moment, you know, after they'd do their thing with it, you know.
And what comes first, music or lyrics?
For me, a lot of times the music.
Yeah. You hear the melody and the line.
And then it kind of gives you an idea where you want to.
And then, but growing up.
Your head, you know.
Going back to the late 60s, you were friends with Jimi Hendrix's drummer.
Yeah.
And you got to jam with Jimi Hendrix. Tell us about that real quick.
Buddy was one of my proteges. I was a drummer for 40 years.
No kidding.
Yeah, I was a jazz drummer. And so we played this place called Allen's Showcase, and Buddy would sneak in the back because he wasn't old enough. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so we, and he'd sit and listen really, really carefully for 3 or 4 hours.
Yeah.
And we'd go through this whole gamut of jazz tunes and stuff.
I just don't think of Jimi Hendrix drummer being a jazz, you know, being influenced by jazz necessarily. Yeah. But
no, I know, but he surely was.
Yeah.
Nate, I got to ask you, I mean, funk rock, he's sitting right here, right? I mean, have you guys ever had a chance to play together?
No,
time.
Well, you guys, could we maybe ask you guys to play something
here? That'll get us an Emmy.
Yeah. Well,
I want to say Minute by Minute for the last break, but can we have you guys just jam on something for a minute?
We'll have the intern that lifted the Hammond B3 give you a hand.
Because
I'm sure he'll be out of the hospital any day now with the back brace.
Legendary.
Buster Abrams. Yes, we have Trace on drums. Yes, we have Nathan East. But the one person that I'm very, very impressed with, and I think in a couple of years, he's going to skyrocket.
Is Trace Hodgins?
Oh. Is the dude on the Hammond B3?
Yeah.
Noah.
Yeah.
Noah, seriously. That I think you have a huge career right in front of you.
Oh, man, I appreciate that.
The Hammond B3 and the other keyboard, there's more ivory there than the elephant exhibit at the zoo. I'm telling you what.
Huh? For me.
Thanks.
But, man, you got to learn some Stevie Winwood, which I probably think you probably do.
Yeah, it's coming.
Can we can we have backstage passes? Can I say right now? Uh-huh. Can we have backstage passes when you play something big? Just because, like, 3 years from now, I don't want to have, like, who is this?
I'll even go to Brazil to see that 250,000 people like that.
Hey, it is the music show, and yes. Our good friend Lauren Finney, who's been a guest of the show many times, has a very special announcement to make, and she's joining us here via Zoom. What's up, girl?
Zoom in.
Lauren.
Hey, Sully, Tommy, Rusty Nailz. Good to see you guys.
So a very special event because our good friend Lauren Finney, who is the star of KUSI every morning. Just don't tell Paul Rudy that. But,
Or
Mark Mathis. But I'm really familiar, Lauren, with this Leukemia Lymphoma Society. And you are, now, does this mean you're going for Woman of the Year or you are Woman of the Year? Because in our book, you're always Woman of the Year.
Well, thank you. So I'm a candidate. There's 11 candidates, I think 7 women. We're going for Woman of the Year. It's a competition. It's a friendly competition, obviously, to see who can raise the most money for leukemia and lymphoma. It certainly feels like we're all just in this to try and make a difference. So it's a very friendly competition, but yes, a candidate for Woman of the Year.
It was a friendly competition until I heard her over the phone before she came on the Zoom, and this is what she was saying to some of the other people in the competition.
I don't ever want to see it again, ever.
No, I'm just teasing. Lauren, okay, so listen, so Thursday night, and what's the date again? Is it the 29th? The 29th. The 29th. Thursday the 29th.
At from the 7, Belly Up.
Right, 7 p.m., Belly Up Tavern, bellyuplive.com. We're doing a live stream. And you're going to have the opportunity to donate live like we've done for so many other organizations. You know, we raised $5,000 for the food bank. We raised like $10,000-$12,000 for CAF. We're going to do the same thing for Lauren and Leukemia and Lymphoma Society. We're going to raise money. I'll announce this now because we haven't said anything. But the Belly Up is producing an album. And we are the album, the Sully Band, and we were in the studio up at A&M Records, now called Henson Recording Studio, where they recorded We Are the World. And I actually had a conversation with Justin Bieber when I was up there. No kidding. But like 4 weeks ago, we were up there recording, so we're going to play some songs from the new deal. We're going to pull out some songs from the old arsenal. We're going to have special guest Rebecca Jade with us. We're going to have Ryan Hiller, Anthony Collins, Whitney Shea. And it's going to be one big show to celebrate Lauren Finney, dang it. No,
it's really not to celebrate me, but it's for everybody that deals with leukemia and lymphoma, and I've had the opportunity to meet so many people over the years that have dealt with this horrible disease, and we're so close to finding better treatments and cures. The ones that pull at my heartstrings, obviously, are the kids. You know, 40% of childhood cancers are leukemia, and there's still, unfortunately, very few drugs that are geared just towards pediatric cancer. So they're getting these cocktails that are, you know, have been around for decades and meant for adults. And so I really think that if we all come together, we raise a lot of money, I know we're close to getting to a point where we should be so that no family has to deal with this again. So I'm so thankful that you are willing to help out and raise money for such a worthy cause.
Well, we will continue to do so. And once again, this coming Thursday night, April 29th, 7 p.m., bellyuplive.com. You can go to bellyuplive.com. I think it's /Sully, but you'll see my picture up there. You'll see Lauren's picture up there. Click on it, and it'll give you text alerts, so you can go on there and you can actually donate live. Rusty Nailz is going to be stop. Let me just talk. Rusty Nailz is I have Tommy and Russ's mic shut off. Rusty Nailz is going to MC the thing. I'm going to try to get Tommy to stop by, try to get Lauren to stop by, and we've got a bunch of special guests. It's going to be fantastic. So Lauren, we're going to do this for you.
I can't wait. I'm going to like blow my bedtime out.
You need to.
I'm ready to rock.
And I want to see the bromance I have with your husband, who makes art Sully Band hats from Melon. Melon.com, L-E-M-I-N.com. I want to see him there busting out some moves because there's only going to be just the crew and you two dancing. So if we can get that going. All right, kiddo. BellyUpLive.com in support of the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society, Lauren Finney's Woman of the Year campaign.
First of all, this has been a great show with the greatest musicians in the world. We got Lester Abrams.
Yeah.
We got Trace on drums. We got Mr. Nathan East and the biggest star of them all, Noah East. Mm-hmm. Noah East right there. We should close out with the song that Lester Abrams wrote with Michael McDonald, Minute by Minute. Sully?
Yeah.
Get on up there and jam with
All right, I'll try to sing along with these guys, but real quick, before I get up there, Noah, we're gonna get a ton of email about you, and it's gonna be from 20-year-old females. What is your Instagram handle so people get a hold of you?
Real easy, just Noah East.
All right, and NathanEastMusic.com, is that right? Is that accurate? NathanEast.com.
So you get in early, you get the cool name.
Lester, you have a website up there we can look at, or we just go look at our old albums?
Lester Abrams Trio.
Yeah. Still around.
All right. Okay. Keep holding on.